Where in space are you taking us today?
So today we're talking about Messier 91. This is a beautiful barred spiral galaxy. It's actually also known as the missing galaxy because in 1781, when Charles Messier discovered this galaxy, he wrote down the wrong coordinates. And for almost 200 years, no one could figure out where this galaxy was or if it actually existed. He wrote down the coordinates with respect to Messier 58, when he should have written it down with respect to Messier 89. People thought maybe he doubly recorded M58. He logged it twice because it's actually quite close in the sky as well. So it wasn't until almost 200 years later, 1969, that an amateur astronomer noticed that the coordinates would work out properly if it was respect to M89 and not M58.
So he was kind of giving the wrong start point, like, you know, turn left then right and all that, but he gave you the wrong the wrong start.
Yeah, exactly. So this galaxy actually was discovered by Herschel 3 years after Messier, so it was already a logged galaxy then as well. Like I said, it's this barred spiral. It's the faintest one in the Messier catalogue, actually. And you can see from the image, it's kind of like washed out. Like, there's not much contrast between the spiral arms and the disk. This is because this galaxy is an anemic galaxy. It's got very low star formation and it's got very little gas content to form stars in the first place. Anemic galaxies tend to live in galaxy clusters. They're not found isolated in the field. And it turns out that this galaxy does belong within a galaxy cluster. It belongs in the Virgo cluster of galaxies. And actually, for a long time, people thought that it didn't belong within Virgo because it's so much dimmer than all the other galaxies in the cluster. And also, its recessional velocity. So, you know, the universe is expanding, right? So all the galaxies are moving away from us. You expect galaxies in the same cluster to move away from us at the same rate. But this one is moving away much slower than all the other galaxies within that cluster. So the galaxies in Virgo have an average recessional velocity of 1,100 kilometers per second, whereas this galaxy has just a recessional velocity of about 500 kilometers per second, so less than half. But they managed to confirm it was part of the galaxy cluster by measuring its distance, and they did that using Cepheid variables. Cepheid variables are stars that pulsate, and they have this very defined pulsation rate against luminosity. So the brighter they are, the faster they pulsate. So if you know how like fast they're pulsating, the period of the pulsation, you can calculate its luminosity. You can compare that to how bright it looks, its apparent magnitude, and that gives you how far away the galaxy is. And based on that, they know it's 63 million light years away. And that's consistent with being within the galaxy cluster.
I'm imagining the reason that you rarely find anemic galaxies outside of clusters is the reason it's anemic is all the other galaxies stole all the gas.
So that's one of the main reasons that you would want to study a galaxy like this one. Galaxies and galaxy clusters are ideal places to study the interactions between galaxies themselves, the interactions between the galaxies and the galaxy cluster, and the interactions between the galaxy and the intercluster medium, so the gas that lives in between the galaxies within this galaxy cluster. One of the explanations for this galaxy being anemic is that because it's in a galaxy cluster, it's moving around in this dense intercluster medium environment, and that strips away all the gas, and that prevents it from forming stars, essentially. But actually, that's not what is happening here. And a hint of this is, like, typically when you see RAM pressure stripped galaxies, you get these jellyfish galaxies, right? Where you can see like the tendrils of stars and dust coming off the galaxy. We don't see that for this galaxy. Actually, what's happening is if you look at the metallicity of this galaxy, the star population is actually not so different from the Milky Way. But what is different is the ratio of iron to hydrogen. So this indicates like how much star formation has happened, because stars, like, they begin with hydrogen and helium, but as you form more and more stars from the kind of stellar wind outputs and the reprocessed gas, then you get more and more iron in these regions. So you get more metallicity, basically. Even though the stellar population of this galaxy is similar to the Milky Way, its iron to hydrogen ratio is 4 times higher. This tells us that this galaxy or the stars have been like having rapid amounts of star formation happening, and that must have used up all of the gas.
It didn't pace itself. It went on an early feeding frenzy.
Essentially. So it's really interesting to study like galaxies within cluster environments, because then you can look at how different their properties are from other galaxies, for example, in the field, or those that have been in clusters for a long time in comparison to those that are falling in. You can look at how their morphology changes, how their luminosity changes, etc.
If there's one thing I've learned from making these videos with you guys about the Messier objects, it's that no two galaxies are the same.
Yeah, it's surprising, isn't it?
Famously, there's a problem with understanding how this structure is there, or at least how it stays there, in that if you look at how fast the galaxy is rotating,